I have basically three things in mind. One is I'm going to talk in general terms about Western, especially American hegemony on all aspects of our life. Secondly, I'm going to relate this to the area of human rights thinking. I have an essay which I'll pass to the organizers, Western Perceptions and Eastern Reflections on Human Rights. And thirdly, Brother Idris has always been saying we have to come out with some suggestions on what to do to resist this Western hegemony in this 21st century. On the first part of Western hegemony, this is very easy to explain and very easy to document, because I think the Marxists told us that the ideas of a ruling class are in every age, the ruling intellectual ideas of the age. This is true domestically, and I think Shobha was pointing that out yesterday about India, and surely this is true internationally. We all know the 19th century belonged to Britain, 20th century belonged to the USA, the 21st century, well, they began it with a bang, the Americans bombing a few countries, threatening others, Iran among them, to give us notice that they intend to maintain their stranglehold on the rest of the world. Now, in my own field, I'm a law teacher. I know that the fundamental jural postulates, assumptions that we make are basically Western. A book in jurisprudence is called Jurisprudence. But if it is on Hindu jurisprudence or Islamic jurisprudence, it will have that initial prefix, Hindu jurisprudence. But a book on Western jurisprudence is Jurisprudence. The concept of law of John Austin, positivist approach, excludes religion, excludes morality, excludes custom, and somehow actually that's the concept that is dominant in our courts, in our legal system. In science, maths, astronomy, medicine, astrophysics, Chinese, Hindu, Mesopotamian, Iranian, Islamic, Mayan contributions are totally ignored. We have heard that plenty of times. Islamic writers, I'm just talking of Islamic civilization, their names were Latinized, their books were translated into Latin. No copyright was given. Those days there were no copyright laws. Now, of course, if you want to translate a book, American book, we have to pay through our nose. So our contributions were denied. And the tragedy is that most Asians do not know what the real contributions of our forefathers were in these fields. In literature, in Malaysian secondary schools, we prescribe Merchant of Venice and Hamlet. Tagore's Gitanjali, nobody prescribes, because after all, that's an Indian book, and Indian books cannot be as good as good old Shakespeare. So I think our basic criterion of evaluation of what is good, what is proper, what is wholesome, what is civilized, they're all Western. I grew up, I'm a graduate of, partly a graduate of one of the American universities. I grew up thinking the rule of law is dicey, separation of powers is Montesque, human rights arose with the Magna Carta, the Bill of Rights, constitutionalism with the American Declaration of Independence, judicial independence with the Act of Settlement 1701, judicial review with Marbury versus Madison. But actually only later in life I realized that many other civilizations, including my own Islamic civilization, had many of these ideas ingrained in them, just that they were unknown to me. There was a constitution of Medina. The Holy Quran definitely prescribes that when you make a decision, hear both sides. To me, that's audi alteram partem, natural justice. There is a concept of proportionality, which the French developed in European administrative law, which actually the Holy Quran specifically mentions, that the punishment must fit the crime. That's proportionality, independence of the judiciary, human rights, not only political and civil rights, socioeconomic rights, a concept of a welfare state, the concept of shura or consultation, religious and cultural pluralism. When the Holy Quran is very, very explicit that if Allah had wanted, he could have made the whole world into one community, but he did not. Are you then going to force people to believe against their will? Explicit passage after passage, actually, whereby there is recognition of diversity, of pluralism, of relativity of values. There was an ombudsman system called Emotasib or Hisba. I know we all grew up to believe ombudsman was a genius of the Scandinavians. Prophet Muhammad's sermon at Arafah has been described by a Sri Lankan scholar as one of the greatest human rights documents. If it had been uttered somewhere in Europe, it would have been framed and hung on the walls of every law school, but because it came from the sands of Arabia, nobody heard about it. In his sermon 1431 years ago, he talked about how the Arab was not superior to the non-Arab, etc. He talked about the need, the possibility of suing him if someone had a claim, make the claim. Veeramantri, by the way, was a Sri Lankan Supreme Court judge. Then he went on for some reason in his retirement to choose Islamic jurisprudence, and he wrote a beautiful small book, but of course he called it Islamic jurisprudence, not jurisprudence. And he mentioned in that book that actually Islamic law, war and peace, in some respects, was far more advanced than many of the Geneva Conventions, because in the Geneva Convention there is concern for the aged, the children, the non-combatants, but in the Islamic law, war and peace, there is concern even for animals, for the livestock, and even for trees. So there was an Islamic law of war and peace long, long time ago. When we talk of the Renaissance, there is obviously only one Renaissance, the European Renaissance. Any other Renaissance, any other civilization was not a Renaissance at all. The principles of equity in Islamic judicial processes were described by Weber, the great Western philosopher, as an aspect of irrationality. Perhaps he didn't mean it badly, but I know that in many Western American judgments, they have mockingly described palm tree justice of the Qadi. Basically, the palm tree justice of the Qadi was not very far away, actually, from the courts of equity, the chancery courts in England, whereby the common law was modified to suit the demands of justice. Now, I'm not implying in any way that Western knowledge must be rejected or that Western knowledge is not on par with Eastern knowledge, not at all. I think that we must all self-educate ourselves because most of us are children of the West. I am a child of the West. I think we need to build a garland of knowledge with flowers from many, many gardens. We need to add this new dimension to our knowledge of adding Hindu and Chinese and Iranian and Persian. Actually, Persian civilization actually long preceded Islam, then Islamic civilization. Eastern contribution must be acknowledged. And certainly the great defect in Western knowledge today is that it does not acknowledge, it does not give tribute to the contribution of other civilizations to our fund of knowledge. All our icons, whether in music or art or culture or in education, are basically Western. The books we prescribe, at least in Malaysia, are Western. Sometimes actually, Claude, we want to draft a syllabus in public administration. We'll get an American fellow, we'll pay him by our nose actually, to draft a Malaysian syllabus on public administration. I mean, the guy doesn't know the ABC of Malaysian government, but actually he's an expert in drafting a syllabi or syllabus on. So I think this is something that obviously is there, Western hegemony, but it's partly because we choose to be that way. Perhaps the mark of oppression runs deep. One of the first things that a colonizer or an oppressor tries to achieve is to control our minds. Well, they have succeeded, and I think we need to educate ourselves now on what has happened to us. Now I come to the next part of my presentation, human rights, Western perceptions and Eastern reflections. I do not wish to imply that there's a total dichotomy between Western views and Eastern views. We are all human beings, and to some extent then, there are some core central beliefs on which we could hold hands. I would like to propose that there is a core of centrality, but of course there is a penumbra, a surrounding area where culture, where history obviously plays a role. Also there is this factor that West and East, North and South, Occident and Orient are not clearly defined terms. Neither region is homogeneous. Waters from many, many shores are mixing, especially in this age of globalization. And I don't regret that at all. I acknowledge there is a great deal that unites us. At the same time, there is a great deal that also divides us. One issue on which I think most of us will not agree on with our Western counterparts is whether the Western record of human rights is in any way superior than us. So the moral, so-called moral superiority of the West, is it a myth or a reality? I wish to say this, that Asia and Africa, certainly past as well as present, including Malaysia today, we have much to be ashamed of. But everyone knows that history will testify that the nations of Europe and North America have a similarly horrendous record of human rights abuses stretching back for centuries. And the worst thing about them is that for the most part, Western civilization has neither acknowledged its brutal past nor apologized for it. Many Asian scholars are quite critical of their own countries. There are some Western scholars, but by far and large, actually, there is an arrogance, there is a feeling of superiority about their own record of human rights, whether it is slavery, whether it is colonialism, whether it is the Holocaust in Germany, the atomic bombing of Hiroshima Nagasaki, whether it's the genocide, 60-year-old genocide in Palestine, the treatment of Aborigines in Australia, of the Indians, Red Indians in North America, the blacks in South Africa, who were killed in cold blood.